Hello everyone, let's get started. My name is Yuri Shlepnev and I'm president and founder of Symbirion Inc., where we develop Symbior electromagnetic signal integrity software for physical design of PCB and packaging interconnects. And the subject of our webinar today is quality of scattering parameter models. And eliminate all noises by muting everyone until the end of the presentation, after which I'll unmute and answer the questions. You can also type the questions into chat window during the presentation. Okay, let's get started. After a brief introduction, I'll define scattering parameters in frequency and time domain. We'll discuss constraints on scattering parameters, introduce quality metrics for reciprocity, passivity, and causality. Next we'll discuss possibility of rational approximation for scattering parameters and final quality metric a single quality metric for touchstone models. I will also show Symbior touchstone analyzer tool. After conclusion, I will answer questions for as long as it takes. Scattering parameters are becoming ubiquitous in design of multi-gigabit interconnects. They can be used for to characterize any linear time invariant system in general, from DC to daylight, connectors, cables, PCBs, packages, optical interconnects. Everything can be expressed in form of scattering parameters. Electromagnetic analysis or measurements are typically the source of such S-parameter models. And very often such models have quality issues. That's why probably you're all here. Reciprocity violation, passivity and causality violation, they go together. And I'll explain why. And common sense violations that sometimes it's hard to spot, sometimes the easiest to spot. And most important, such models may produce different time and even frequency domain responses in different solvers. So it indicates a general problem. You take one solver, do time domain analysis, you get one results. Get another solver and you get another results. Which one is correct? I hope that I'll answer on those questions in my presentation. Considering definition of scattering parameters, I should say that I'll provide just basic terminology introduction, and if you want deep knowledge, you have to pick up some books on microwave engineering or attend Eric Bagatin's classes on scattering parameters. But in general, a multiport is a structure with a defined ports, and a port is a two-terminal structure where one of the terminals may be considered as a local ground and voltage measured with respect to this local ground, and current goes in and out, equal current. If we have such definition of ports, and those may be just regular voltages and currents, or maybe projections on waves, on electric and magnetic waves. Those definitions are useful for waveguiding structures, and we are dealing with the waveguiding structures with interconnects. So currents and voltages can be united in vectors, like it is shown here. In addition, one more thing, scattering parameters of multiport are defined with normalization and termination impedance. So it's not a black box definition completely. It requires some normalization or termination. As soon as we know such normalization or termination, we can define incident wave or reflected waves. And I'll explain a little later what they mean physically. As soon as we've got incident and reflected waves, we can relate them with a matrix. In this case, if those n n-port structure, we have n by n complex matrix, and the definition of matrix element essentially provides explains what is scattering parameters. If you have unit incident wave, for instance, at one port and measure reflected and zero incident wave at another ports and measure reflected waves, we can uniquely define one column of scattering matrix. In application to two-port parameters, scattering matrix is 2 by 2, and we can define reflection as reflected wave ratio to incident wave ratio at port number 1, and transmission parameter as B2, for instance, divided by A1. Physically, square of magnitude of each wave is a power of incident wave or reflected wave. That can be useful to actually understand why the S parameters are limited by 1. In another useful thing is that reflection in interconnects is usually unwanted and transmission is wanted parameter. So this should be 0, this should be close to 1. We can also define voltages and currents using the waves and introduce some other measures that might be useful to characterize the interconnects. Scattering parameters are usually available in two forms, either as analytical models, those are lumped circuits, or rational broadband spice macro models, or equivalent distributed models, models that are described with analytical or semi-analytical expressions. More often we deal with tabulated or discrete touchstone models. Such models came from probably from one of the from microwave software, mostly eSoft, as I remember, they introduced first those models. And the first microwave analysis software was based completely on scattering parameters. SPICE simulators now produce scattering parameters, electromagnetic analysis software, and obviously measurement equipment. And the fact that scattering parameters are extremely convenient to measure because of powers can be measured, phases can be measured, we can measure them. And VNA and TDNA produce discrete touchstone models. Common defects in scattering parameters are bandwidth deficiency, discreteness, and distortion due to some factors listed here. So considering bandwidth deficiency, scattering parameters are band limited due to limited capabilities of solvers and measurement equipment. This is just natural. In reality, when we use such models, they should, in interconnect analysis, they should always include DC point or allow extrapolation, or high frequency and extend to high frequencies that are defined by signal spectrum. And we'll discuss this bandwidth requirements later. Touchstone models are discrete. It's just a set of matrix element at particular frequencies. It means that in analysis you often have to use interpolation of data, both for frequency and time domain analysis. Well, other model distortions are simulation artifacts, measurement artifacts such as de-embedding, simulation artifacts such as convergence and solver, or use different techniques and different bandwidths and so on. There are passivity violations and local enforcement. I'll show some examples of such models. There are also causality violations and enforcement, brute force enforcement and software that also produce a lot of bad models. Well, in general, those are mistakes of human, of model developers and model users. The problem is how to rate the quality of the models. And I hope that I'll be able to answer this question today. So If you take a look, this diagram explains a lot of problems around scattering parameters. So if you think about scattering parameters in frequency domain, if you have defined stimulus, time harmonic stimulus, scattering matrix measured at some frequencies, we can easily compute response, system response using this equation as a in a stamp or something like this. So just simply converting S parameters to Y parameters. Well, there are no problems of simulation at different frequencies. But as soon as we start thinking about time domain analysis and we have some stimulus defined in time domain, we need impulse response matrix. And related with the original scattering parameters defined in frequency domain through the Fourier transform. Inverse Fourier transform, essentially. And if you want a system response, we need to do a convolution with this impulse response. And the problem is always with this infinite integrals and requirements for that scattering parameters have to be, or impulse response matrix have to be continuous function of time scattering parameters and frequency domain continuous function of frequency. So this is a basic explanation of why we have those problems. If we had those all matrices and signals defined from DC to infinity, we wouldn't have such problems. We would just go easily from one domain to another without any problem. But how to deal with this with a discrete scattering parameters? Well, obviously we can use discrete Fourier transform and discrete convolution. This approach in general is slow and may require interpolation and extrapolation of tabulated S parameters. So that's interpolation because of we have discrete S parameters at discrete points. Extrapolation because of the actual required bandwidth may be larger than in a particular available for a particular model. So all this introduce some uncontrollable error. Some typical problems with DFT analyzing this Peter Popolaikis paper. I recommend to read it. Very interesting investigation. Well, another approach is to approximate discrete scattering parameters with frequency continuous rational functions. In this case, the accuracy can be controlled over defined frequency band. You can always see this error and make a decision. Is this good or bad? With the passivity enforcement on such rational approximation, the model becomes causal and defined from DC to infinity. And passivity enforcement for a complete matrix model is a very essential part of this. And I'll talk more about this later. We can with a rational approximation we can use fast recursive convolution algorithms obviously, and get results consistent in time and frequency domain across different solvers. Well, unfortunately, not all touchstone models are suitable for either approach. So we have to distinguish between those models that can be used and what cannot be used. And to do this, I would like to discuss some constraints on scattering parameters, physical constraints. Obviously, time domain impulse response matrix should be a real function of time, and that means that scattering parameters real part of scattering parameter should be even function of frequency, and imaginary part should be odd function of frequency as illustrated right here. Typically it is all satisfied because of we don't have scattering parameters at negative frequencies. But except one condition, it's zero derivative of scattering parameters at zero right here. Next is causality constraint. And causality can be defined as impulse response, zero impulse response before time zero. or zero response before some delay time. This is all always ambiguous because of in reality we deal with systems that have dispersion, so it means that some frequency components propagate faster, and we usually have some onset and signal right here in form of ripples or some Gaussian shape. And another thing is we have multiple on a typical board we have multiple propagation paths, so it may bring some responses right here. Cutting those off, we can essentially throw very useful information. So using this definition of causality, we can derive other equations in frequency domain. So this is in time domain. If you formulate it and use signal function and knowing the Fourier transform of the signal function, we end up with a Gilbert transform shown right here. So S parameter should satisfy this equation, and this is a simple derivation of this equation. And it leads to Cramer's chronic relations between imaginary and real part of scattering parameters. So knowing imaginary part, we can compute real. Knowing real part, we can compute imaginary part. Well, this is really useful property, but again, we see those infinite integrals, continuous functions. In reality, we can only approximately use this to evaluate the causality. It cannot be directly used due to, again, band-limitedness and discreteness of scattering parameters, available scattering parameters. Some boundaries can be introduced to, separate causal from non-causal. But unfortunately, even if such tests pass, a lot of uncertainties remains due to band-limitedness. You do not really know usable model or not, even if the model if the causality test based on Cramer's chronic S parameters Cramer's chronic transformation passes. So there are some heuristic tests like vector rotation tests shown here. So it is based on observation that most of the causal systems or S parameters describing interconnects causal sets of S parameters, they have clockwise rotation. If you take three consecutive points on a polar plot for scattering parameters, and polar plot is imaginary from real, we can see that most of the time those are rotating clockwise. So if you compute this angle and compare it with the total rotation, heuristic number is if the rotation is 80% of the time clockwise, then system is probably causal, or at least it passes this test. For instance, a computed a modeled system does not pass this test, it usually means that it's undersampled. So it means that the model may need some more frequency points. The counterclockwise rotation happens only at the resonance point, and the number of such resonances in a typical interconnect system is very small. So this causality test usually has to provide causality metric close to 100%. Unfortunately, when we deal with measured data, and especially with small S parameters, small by value like reflection, and especially in cases when some kind of dim bedding used to post-process scattering parameters, we can end up with polar plots looking like this. Obviously, any causality test based on rotation will fail. So For such system, we'll need some additional evaluation of data. So this is an example of system that produces actually usable data, but causality test based on rotation failed. After some improvement, it was usable. And this example actually was used in one of our tutorials at DesignCon, and materials from that tutorial with more details on how the models was handled are available on our website. The references are at the end of the presentation. So, speaking of causality, we immediately have to bring passivity into the picture. And those are very related subjects, and I'll try to explain it today. Essentially, in first I'll start from passivity definition and time domain. A system is passive if incident wave, power of incident wave, minus power of reflected wave is always greater or equal to zero. If this equation holds, then the system is passive, so it doesn't generate power. If the system is passive according to this definition, then it is also causal. And the proof exists in this paper, but it's really kind of easy to see from this equation. If incident power is zero and this equation holds, then this equation should be less or equal to zero. That means the only one solution is reflected wave is zero. So the, technically we need to check only passivity of interconnect system. Very easy. Well, let's try to do it in frequency domain. In frequency domain, power absorbed by the system can be defined by incident wave power minus reflected power of reflected waves, all reflected waves. So with knowing that we can always compute reflected waves through incident wave with S parameters, we end up with a quadratic form that looks like this. And quadratic form is non-negative if this matrix right here has only positive or zero eigenvalues. Or in other words, all eigenvalues of this matrix are below unit or equal to unit. So in this case, the system does not generate energy. Well, unfortunately, to make a decision on the passivity of the system, we have to verify this equation from DC to infinity. Only in this case, we can conclude that the system is passive. If we verified it at a discrete set of frequencies, this is insufficient condition. It doesn't mean that the system described by that S parameters is passive. It means that when we do the computation in time domain, we may need to extend scattering parameters to some higher frequencies, and such extension may produce non-causal data. So a summary of properties of good touchstone models is here, shown on this slide. The system must be passive, do not generate energy, which means that eigenvalues of this matrix is below equal to unit from DC to infinity. This is really important to understand. Well, system must be reciprocal. I didn't talk about reciprocity. Reciprocity is one of the most fundamental principles. In case of application to scattering parameters, it just means that scattering parameters are scattering matrix is symmetric, must be symmetric. The system, the model has to satisfy causality, and well, we discussed that it's practically impossible to evaluate or causality with a discrete bandwidth limited data set. In addition, the data have must have sufficient bandwidth matching the signal spectrum and must be appropriately sampled to resolve all resonances. We'll talk about those two items in context of rational approximation a little bit later. So it, what if system does not satisfy all those conditions? We can introduce some metrics, at least for those frequencies where we know data in touchstone model file. So, for instance, for passivity, we can introduce a passivity metric at one frequency as maximal eigenvalue of this matrix. It should be below a unit or equal unit. And then use this metric to come up with a number that ranges from 0 to 100, and 100% is completely passive set, data set, and 0 means that there are big violations in data set. In considering reciprocity, we can also introduce metric for at one frequency as a actual non-symmetry in the matrix, and then introduce metrics that characterize the whole data set at all frequencies, all available frequencies. Well, it shows here that those metrics should be typically above 99%, 100% is the best case. Considering causality, we can measure it as minimal ratio clockwise rotation to total rotation. And minimal means we go through the set of scattering parameters and compute this matrix for S11, for instance, S12, S13, and so on, and take the minimal value. So typically, reflection coefficients, small reflection coefficients, they deliver the highest violation in causality, especially in measured scattering parameters. So obviously, well, the question is what to do if models do not produce exactly 100% passivity, reciprocity, and causality. So we introduce some brackets right here. For a good model, passivity and reciprocity should be above 99.9%. How do we know this? Well, we have at Cimberian we have thousands of models from our partners, customers, and we tested all those metrics on those models before coming out with this metrics at first at DesignCon at 2010, IBIS Forum at DesignCon. Well, the metrics I should say are not standardized by IBIS committee. They are always considering doing something like this, but still didn't do this. So I essentially provide all materials for them on this subject. All those metrics are essentially open to anyone to implement. The model may be considered as acceptable if passivity and reciprocity are above 99% and causality falls into bracket from 80 to 50%. And the model is inconclusive, and this is additional state that we have to deal with, and I'll tell more what we can do about this state. And the models may be considered bad if passivity and reciprocity falls below 80%. For causality, we cannot say this because of measured models, you saw this noise effect. So such models have to be discarded immediately, even in preliminary investigation. In addition, our Simbior software, we use some color codes for different brackets for each particular metric for convenience to see the picture. And to illustrate this usefulness of such color coding and icons, I can show a sample of touchstone analyzer screen where a set of models is analyzed, preliminary analyzed on passivity, reciprocity, and causality. You can see that there are a lot of models that have zero causality, and those are measured models, and they fall into inconclusive state because of also there is some inconclusive state in passivity. And what to do with this model, I'll tell a little bit later. But there are models that have all green and all models that also acceptable, and those, by the way, also came from measurement. So it doesn't mean that model came from measurement always have zero causality. No, not always. Well, what to do with such models, especially in conclusive, in questionable state? The best approach found so far is a rational approximation. We can use this discrete data set and construct a rational approximation for each element of scattering matrix using existing frequency points. Such approximation can be done either with the delay extraction or with multiple delay extraction and so on. The common properties of such models is impulse response is analytical and delay causal, the causality here is just for one element. If in addition a passivity is enforced for scattering matrix approximated with the rational approximation, and this is done from zero to infinity, and it can be done, then such model may be considered passive and causal. Well, and reciprocal if such condition is enforced. Well, what is good about this model? The model is frequency continuous model, and it naturally usually extrapolates to DC and to infinity. A few notes on how the models, such models can be constructed, on the requirements, on the bandwidth, and sampling. Technically, if those conditions here are violated, the model is also useless. So, for instance, if DC point is missing, the lowest frequency in the sweep should be below skin effect or below the first possible resonance in the system. This is a formal definition. Sometimes those conditions are violated, and the extrapolation to DC is just garbage. The highest frequency in the sweep should be or must be defined by the requirement on either resolution in time domain or by spectrum of the signal. So essentially, your signal defines the bandwidth of your model, your signal, your system defines the lowest frequency where you can start the analysis or measurement. Your signal defines the bandwidth. And this is just an example right here. It's not a rule. You can use other rules like 4 or 5 times of the dominant spectral frequency and so on. In any case, this is how the models have to be then assembled or selected. The sampling is very important for discrete Fourier transforms, but for rational approximations, it's relaxed requirement. So you must have 4 or 5, sometimes even less, frequency point per each resonance. But in any case, the electrical length of a system should not change more than a quarter of wavelength between consecutive points. This is essentially a requirement defined by the length of your system. The sampling is defined by the electrical length of your system. So as soon as all those conditions are satisfied, you build a rational approximation, and you can use this rational approximation to compute time domain response with fast recursive convolution. It's much faster than any type of Dirac convolution, and exact for piecewise linear signals. You can convert those rational approximations into SPICE macro model. Such models are much smaller, and they produce consistent frequency and time domain analysis in any solver that supports such models. Typically, HSPICE compatible solvers available anywhere where people use signal integrity analysis. Such models can be used to improve quality of tabulated touchstone models. I'll provide an example later. One of the most interesting things in context of this presentation, such models can be used to measure the quality of the original model. And that's how it can be done. We take original tabulated model and a rational macro model that approximates this original model, and then simply measure the distance between the models in form of root mean square error. And if you express this root mean square error again in percent, ranging from 0 to 100%, if root mean square is essentially 0, then we have 100% quality of the model. So the model is ideally represents this discrete data set. In reality, we have to introduce again brackets. A model may be considered as good as if root mean square falls into this bracket, and in percent, it's model quality from 99 to 100%. Acceptable if this range from 90 to 99. And inconclusive, in this case, you have to really take a closer look at the model. Where those violations, where those discrepancy between the original and rational approximation model happens. If it happens at high frequency, then you should rate model appropriately, not going all the way up to, let's say, 20 gigahertz, but maybe to 15 gigahertz, and so on. So the model bandwidth should be essentially degraded or derated. In case if the approximation is not possible, such models have to be discarded. Well, usually we recommend to give it a second try and use some options in our Symbior software that uses very advanced model building longer. It's longer, but it finds the best available, the best possible model for a given data set. If this is not possible, if model quality is still bad, then such model has to be discarded. So this is an example of the final quality estimation, exactly the same models as I shown on the previous slide. Only here we don't have causality column for all the models that have rational macro model build. And you can see that from questionable state, practically all models fell into the acceptable state. So it means that the rational approximations for such models were successful and they can be safely used for the analysis in your system. Next, I will do a brief demonstration of our Symbior Touchstone Analyzer tool. It's a part of Symbior environment that processes touchstone models, estimate passivity, reciprocity, causality, and final quality metrics, can be used to export, improve either improved touchstone models or broadband spice macro models, and within Symbior it can be also such models can be used to build step pulse response or other time domain responses. Essentially, touchstone analyzer is an industry first quality assurance and macro modeling automation tool. And let's just switch to Symbior and I will demonstrate it. So this is how Symbior looks like when I open it. And to launch Touchstone Analyzer, I can use this button from the toolbar. As soon as I launch Touchstone Analyzer, it goes and scans my computer, pretty much like Picasa, and finds all models, all Touchstone models on my computer. And in addition, it rates the quality of such models automatically. So I stop the automatic scanning. And I have thousands of models on my computer, so it may take a while to get all of them. And I go into this directory where I have some prepared models for this demonstration. When I switch to tabulated view, I immediately see my set of models, like this GBX connector model right here. I can plot it in this window and plot it in single-ended mode, differential mode, just by switching those buttons. I can select a matrix element I want to plot. I can select also what I want to plot, like simple scattering parameter presentation, so YZ parameters all available. And in addition, you can plot also quality metrics like passivity. That should be below unit as we discussed here. But in this model, we have some slight violations. And so the model in passivity and also in reciprocity, if I check the reciprocity of this model, I can see this violation reciprocity should be zero always. But with at higher frequencies, we can see considerable violation of the reciprocity here for this model. So I can also plot all other parameters like power sum crosstalk, insertion loss to power sum crosstalk ratio, all compliance metrics technically used in frequency domain for 10G Ethernet. So let's return to magnitude. And the next step, this model is essentially an inconclusive state. And what to do about it? Well, I can, and this is just preliminary estimation. To estimate it, a final quality metric, I switch to this screen or dialog to build rational compact model, and I build it to estimate the actually final quality metric for this model. And the final quality metric here is 98.1%. It's acceptable, essentially. And so after this, and building this model in options, there was passivity and reciprocity enforcement. So the racial macro model is passive from DC to infinity, extrapolated to DC and to infinity, and reciprocal. So it's all causal. So to, using this model, I can I have few options right here. I can either produce improved touchstone model. I click export, and immediately I have my model with improved characteristic. If I plot it with and compare with the original model, you can see they technically on top of each other. So, but the new model is extended to some frequencies that can be redefined in SymBiore, and the new model is also extended to DC, extrapolated to DC. So we can either use this new model or use this one and produce broadband spice macro model. So I click export, and then the model is written next to this. I can see the model right here. The model contains some Laplace sources, so it can be safely used in any system level analysis tool with the same result in time and frequency domain. So the model building can be done very quickly for either this is small 4x4 model. Here we have some also models for with larger number of ports. Let me take a look where they are. Well, such as 48 pin connector, it can be quickly plotted in both single-ended space or mixed mode, and can be also converted into rational macro model. So I click build RCM and it goes and build this model for 48 pin connector. While it's building, we can browse some other things right here. So for instance, those measured model have zero causality, and some model have to be discarded immediately, like this one. There are huge violations in all quality metrics, like passivity quality metric, reciprocity, and all the rest. So such model has to be just deleted. This one has large passivity violation right here. Some models can be, we can see that some models, and right here, manipulated model, if you take a look at passivity, for instance, measure of this model, we can immediately see that the model has 100% passivity, 100% causality or reciprocity, but when we take a look at passivity metric, we can see that the model was actually, passivity was enforced by brute force, and that typically violate causality, and then rational macro model building for such model may produce really low quality model. So meanwhile, we have our model built right here for 48 pin connector, and the model can be now either converted into a rational macro model or resampled or and reused. So it's really quick, and the model has acceptable quality now. And you can see all the progress and everything here in SymBiore. So actually, all this model building and can be done in a bunch for the whole directory, for instance. And I did it in one of our demo videos, and you can switch to this demo or you can view this demo video. But the result of this model building are shown in this directory. So all the bad models are discarded, and only acceptable models are remaining. So, and some of them are really actually showing as good models, and those are also measured models. Not all models are built with a tool. So now, if you have this, for instance, GBX connector model. Now we have option to do time domain analysis either with and I switch to magnitude right here. In frequency domain, our rational approximation will produce almost identical result for both models in any solver now. But what about the time domain analysis? If I For time domain analysis, I create a new project within Symbior and bring those two models. And this is model with a rational macro model, and I compute time domain response matrix for this with a rational approximation. Launch the analysis and plot the result. And now I want to take a look at TDR response of this GBX connector and just proceed with all default values right here and select this model and plot one row of time domain response matrix. So we can see the time domain response of this connector computed with rational macro model. What if we do the same without rational macro model using inverse Fourier transform? Well, this is one of the good tests for consistency of the data. Now, if I plot this data on the same graph with a time domain response matrix computed with rational approximation, it should produce identical result. So, and now we can see virtually identical results. So, you can see that the data are virtually overlap. So, this it means that new resample model is perfectly suitable for analysis with inverse Fourier transform, but the better approach is actually use this rational approximation. So I demonstrated all those items here, and in conclusion, a few recommendations on how to avoid problems with scattering parameter models, and those recommendations for all model builders or model users. First, use reciprocity, passivity, and causality metrics for preliminary investigation. Discard all models if they have large passivity and reciprocity violation. Such models are not restorable. We may throw information with such enforcement. So if it happens at high frequencies, for instance, you can just derate the model to lower frequency. In this case, so there might be still usable information in those models. Rational models can be used to compute final quality measure of models. Good models always can be approximated easily with the rational functions, with the passive and causal rational functions. If it is not possible, again, the model must be discarded or frequency range derated. Unfortunately, even if models pass all those quality metrics, they may be still not usable. For instance, due to band limitedness, sometimes people say, well, I do 10 gigabit per second analysis of 10 gigabit per second data channel, and I need models only up to 5 gigahertz. This is really unrealistic. And that's how essentially we figure it out from questioning our customers or our visitors of our website. And sometimes they answer on question what data or what is the frequency range of interest for them. That kind of unrealistic. For 10 gigabit per second, it should be at least 20 gigahertz. So, essentially, if you approximate any system with a rational macro model, then resample it, then such model is going to be passive, causal, everything would be good, but how close this model to the original model? Maybe it's not essentially what was. We don't know what it was in the beginning. Such all those improvement models have to be done with really cautiously, with a lot of investigations. Any case, as soon as you get this rational approximation, then this is natural after this to use frequency continuous broadband SPICE macro models instead of the original discrete data sets. So if you have any questions offline, feel free to contact me, and I unmute everyone. Okay. And I'm ready to take questions.